Welcome back to A Game of Thanks and Thrones. My name's Hannah, and this is my December wrap-up. Now, in December, I read a total of 17 books, mostly 4 stars, which in my personal reading tastes means my star rating means that I enjoyed these books. I think that's what 4 star means for most people. But we are just going to dive right in. So the first two books are A Discovery of Witches by Deborah Harkness and After Your Age, Eve Brown by Talia Hibbert. Technically, I did finish these in November, but by the time I'd finished those, I'd already filmed my November wrap-up, which is why they're being talked about in December. So, Discovery of Witches by Deborah Harkness got 4 stars from me. I did enjoy it. I didn't love it as much as I thought I would, but I did find it very intriguing. Some bits were a little bit confusing, I'm not gonna lie, but I do have the sequel on my priority list. So hopefully some of the things that I was confused about will be explored in that second book when I get around to it. But this follows our main characters, Diana, who is a witch, although she's not practicing witch no more, and Matthew, who is a vampire. Now, Diana is a historian like Deborah Harkness herself, so there is that level of detail to it in the story. You can tell that Deborah has done her research. But Diana is a researcher, she's a historian, I think, an archivist. I'm not 100% sure, it was over a month ago when I read this. But when Diana comes across a manuscript in the Bodleian... Is that Bodleian Library? Can you say Bodleian Library? I don't think so. That might be from something... That might be something else. But when she comes across this manuscript that all of these supernatural creatures in the world are wanting, she becomes a target, and Matthew, for reasons of his own, steps in to not only protect the manuscript, which is what he was there for originally, but he ends up falling for Diana and starting a forbidden relationship. It was very good. There are aspects of Matthew's personality that are a bit chauvinistic. He is a bit sexist at times, which, when you think about how old Matthew is and the era that he comes from, it was expected of the time, and he does do a good job of recognizing that times have changed and learning from that and learning to fit in with the new order of things. So in this world we have the witches, the vampires, and the demons. Witches are born from witches, vampires are created from vampires, and nobody really knows where the demons come from. They can be born to witches' families, or they can be born to normal families, and the demons are usually your tortured artists. But this got 4 stars, and I am intrigued to pick up the sequel, which is Shadow of Night. Then we have After Age, Eve Brown by Talia Hibbert. This is the, as of yet, conclusion of the Brown Sisters companion trilogy, following each of the Brown Sisters, with it starting with Chloe, who is the oldest, Danny, who is the middle child, and then obviously Eve, who is the youngest. I like this one because Eve is obviously the youngest. She's always been told at her age nobody seems to take her seriously, and she flits from one project to another. The latest disaster being a wedding planner business that went really well on her behalf, but there was an incident with the bride and some pigeons that meant Eve had to, in her mind, end that business. So then she escapes to the Lake District, because obviously Talia Hibbert is English, which is a nice bonus. So she runs away to the Lake District, comes across a sign advertising for a new chef in this local B&B, run by Jacob, and Jacob is autistic, and he is very uptight. He likes routine, he likes basically he is everything that Eve is not, and this is the Sunshine and Grumpy trope, and I really enjoyed it. I love how on this one, more so than the other two, the relationship felt like it had more time to blossom and grow. I know people, for a lot of people, this one isn't their favourite. I don't think I have a favourite. I like them all equally for different reasons. But 5-star, and I will be looking out for more of Talia Hibbert's work. Then, if you saw my December TBR video, you'll know that I decided to mood read for December. So these are all random, apart from one. But we have Midnight in Everwood by M.A. Guznier. I gave this one 5 stars. I thoroughly enjoyed the story of Marietta growing a backbone in a beautifully written historical time period of Nottingham 1906. Of course, this is English. It's going to get a bonus of me for that one. But basically, this is the story of the Nutcracker. Marietta is our ballerina who just wants to be on stage. She is given a chance to audition for a big company. I can't remember the exact details. But as she is a society lady, her father puts his foot down and says no. In the new year, she must marry. In comes Dr. Drosselmeyer, who, if you know of the Nutcracker story, you'll know he's not to be trusted. And he enchants the Stell family with his miniatures, his clockworks, and then on Christmas Eve, he enacts his deadly plan, and from what happens afterwards, Marietta learns that there's more to her than just the dance. She learns strength, she learns how to take her what she wants in a way that doesn't harm her, doesn't harm anybody else, it just breaks their expectations and allows her to be who she truly is. Back up, 5-star. Next was The Winter Garden by Alexandra Bell. Again, this got 5 stars. It was a beautiful story of grief and dealing with grief, and again subverting people's expectations and doing what you want. But when she was 8 years old, Beatrice Retreat received an invitation to the Winter Garden. She visited there for about a week after her mother died, and it was filled with all sorts of wonders and mysterious things. But then, as suddenly as this garden appeared, it vanishes. Flash forward to 18 years later, and Beatrice is being told, in typical Victorian fashion, that she has to marry. Now, the man that they have that her aunt has chosen for her to marry, is not Beatrice's choice, but her late father was fond of the man. So she feels that she has to honour her late father by marrying this Duke. Beatrice doesn't like the Duke, so she stands him up on their wedding, which to me was brilliant. Beatrice does have a stammer, as well as being sure of herself that she doesn't want to marry not just this Duke, but ever. And we know that in Victorian society, being different or being impaired in some way was not a good thing. So we have that. So Beatrice steps down from the spotlight, which she doesn't want to be in, and then the Duke is all affronted, but he proposes to Beatrice's friend Rosa, and Rosa lives the life that Beatrice should have led. All is rosy on the surface, except for when the invitations come. Now, this is an invitation to compete, to build a pleasure garden with the prize being a wish of your choosing. So Rosa and Beatrice embark on the competition, as well as learning a few home truths about themselves that they might not necessarily want to learn. So this is a story of grief, of subverting expectations. There are triggers in this for medical, I'm just going to say medical, I don't know the term for it. There's also abuse, a big, big trigger for grief, so, and maybe depression. So if you are sensitive to any of those, just be wary before you pick this one up. But I thoroughly enjoyed it and I gave it 5 stars. The topics on grief and depression were very well handled, in my personal opinion. Then we have a middle grade. I think I went on middle grade madness. I think that's the title of that week's vlog. And I read so much in that week. The first being Darwin's Dragons by Lindsay Galvin. And is anybody surprised that this got 5 stars? I absolutely adored this story. It is set in Darwin, in Victorian times, with Darwin in 1835. We follow a young cabin boy called Sims, who is on the adventure of a lifetime with Charles Darwin on board the Beagle. Sims is acting as Darwin's assistant. But then Sims falls overboard and is washed up on one of the Galapagos Islands, I can't remember exactly which one, and he finds a lizard that doesn't turn out to be a lizard. They take these and he rescues the eggs and he takes them to London, where all sorts of madness happens. Queen Victoria is not portrayed as a nice person in this. She is only a teenager, but still, she's a bit of a brat. Yes, I can say that as an English woman. But 5 stars, and there are really cool illustrations on the chapter headings of this. So, and I just really enjoyed this one. Perfect for anybody who does like dragons, or even just adventure stories. Then I picked up How Not to Be a Vampire Slayer by Katie Birchall. This follows Maggie as she moves into a new town. She's basically unfazed by anything and everything, makes her way to this spooky wood as a bit of a dare by her new best friends, and finds a creepy castle, a vegetarian vampire, and an ancient book naming her as the latest of the Hell's Slayers. And I thoroughly enjoyed this. I gave it 4 stars, as there were things that I didn't quite enjoy as much. I think everything was just a bit too convenient. I have seen this in both middle grade children's sections of Waterstones and YA. Now I think it is more older middle grade than YA, which would make sense for some of the plot lines. But I did enjoy it. I did like the ending on how certain characters are portrayed and why they did what they did. But some of it was just a little bit too on the nose and a bit too convenient for my personal tastes reading this as a YA. I think if I reread it with the mindset of a middle grade, that might not bug me as much. And then we have a 5 star. This book made me cry. It took my heart, wrenched it, broke it in two, put it back together, and then broke it again. And this is Dragon City by Katie and Kevin Tsang. This is the 3rd book in the Dragon Realm series, which started with Dragon Mountain and continued on in Dragon Legend. And all 3 of these books have been 5 stars for me. But we follow Billy, who is an American Chinese young boy who was sent to a summer camp in China to learn about his Chinese heritage. While there, he meets three other characters who become his best friends in this camp. They go on They manage to get stuck in this mountain and bring back dragons. And I don't really want to tell you much more about that because of spoilers, but this book and the end of Dragon Legend, you will need tissues and chocolate. It is brilliant. And I think this book in particular did end the first arc, the first story arc, beautifully, and it did give some important lessons, I think. And the third one is coming out soon and starts off a whole other story arc, and that is Dragon Rising, and that's coming out in March 22, so not too long. I'm just going to pop you in a different angle so I can charge. Bear with. Right, that's better. Camera's on charge so I can talk as long as I want without the camera beeping at me, in theory. So carrying on Middle Grade Madness, which makes it sound awful, but I really enjoyed myself that week. So we have Pages and Co. Tilly and the Book Wanderers by Anna James. This is book one of the book one of the series. And I give this 4 stars. It was fun. I did like some of the elements. There's something that I didn't quite love about it, and I'm not sure 100% what it is. Maybe it was a bit too slow to get going, and I just felt like the initial plot, there was a lot of world building, a lot of explanation, which is fine, especially since this is a long book, and it is, I think most of the books are quite long, and it would take a while to get the story going and explain some of the abilities, because basically Tilly can jump into the pages of her favourite books, and she can bring the characters of her favourite books out into real life. And she's hoping that new power will solve the mystery of her mother, because her mother seemed to go missing all those years ago, and it does to a degree. It just takes a long time to get to that point. There is a line on the back, I just basically quoted at you, and that is the climax of the book almost. It takes so long to get going, but I did love it. I did enjoy reading about Alice and Anne of Green Gables, as they are Tilly's favourite characters. And I think when you know a character that well, that they do feel real to you. Well, isn't that all what readers want? They want to feel like they know these characters, and Tilly has that ability. And I am looking forward to picking up the sequel. It's just not a priority. So 4 stars, would recommend to anybody who likes books, or just anybody who's wanting to get, because I'd say that this is older middle grade as well. Sophia, for England, I would say probably year 5, year 6 school aged children, to maybe like 8 to 12, maybe, depending on the age of the reader and their comfortability. I did like the villain though. The villain was a nice touch. Howl's Moving Castle by Diana Wynne Jones. I gave this 4 stars. I think it was very well done, because I've watched the movie first. But this follows Sophie Hatter, who attracts the unwelcome attention of the Witch of the Waste, who curses her to be an old woman. And then old Sophie comes across Howl and his moving castle, and has to be wary because it is rumoured that Howl, as a magician, eats the hearts of young girls. And I did enjoy this. It was whimsy and just everything I expected from this, bearing in mind that my knowledge and reference points were the movie first. But I kind of preferred the movie. I think this had, in my personal opinion, had too much going on for it. And there were extra characters in this who weren't present in the movie, and the movie just simplifies things, which I think was better. But it did keep the main focus of the book of the plot. But I would recommend this. Just read this before you watch the movie, because the movie simplifies a lot and does remove some of the, not key characters, but some of the more extra characters who pad out the plot in this a little bit more, like Sophie's sisters. I think they're mentioned in the movie, but they're not, you don't actually see them. Then we have Wundersmith, The Calling of Morrigan Cole by Jessica Townsend. This is book two, the first book being, what was the third book called? How can I forget? I know it was The Trials of Morrigan Cole. I just can't remember what the... Oh, Nevermore. That was it. Nevermore, The Trials of Morrigan Cole. This is obviously the sequel. And the third book is Hollowpox, The Hunt for Morrigan Cole, which I don't own for 20. This is obviously the sequel, and it was just as good as the first. I gave this 4 stars. I just didn't get that same sense of whimsy that I got from the first one. I think this one may be suffering from second book syndrome, but I can't be sure. I still would recommend the first book, but I can't really talk too much about this one with it being a sequel. But basically, in Nevermore, we follow Morrigan, who is a cursed child, and anything and everything that goes wrong in her village is blamed on her. Also being a cursed child, Morrigan believes that she is destined to die on her birthday, but in comes Jupiter North, who is ginger and eccentric and brilliant, and he whisks her away. I think I know why I don't like this one as much. This one, in my opinion, focuses too much on the darkness and the potential fallout of the first book, rather than the whimsy and the magic that I got from the first book. This one just feels a lot more darker, which in itself is a good thing, but I just felt that this was too dark, potentially too dark, and didn't have as much lighter moments for me to fully enjoy it. But I am intrigued and awaiting getting my hands on the third book, which I believe is out in paperback. If not, it will be soon, so keep your eye out for a potential haul. Then we have Jade Fire Gold by June C.L. Tan. This got 5 stars. It is this isn't the Six Crimson Cranes retelling. I thought it might be. But this is your typical boy meets girl, girl has magic, boy wants to save the world type doodah. But it's so much more than that, and it is so richly developed. It has a slow, it has such a good storyline to it. I'll just read you the synopsis, because I do know that I really enjoyed it, but I just can't tell you why. But Anne is no one with no past and no future. Altan is a lost heir, his future stolen away as a child. When they meet, Altan sees in Anne a path to reclaiming the throne, and sees a way to finally unlock her past and understand her lethal magical abilities. But they may have to pay a far deadlier price than either of them could have imagined. So, this is the beautiful fairy lift edition, and I gave this 5 stars. Then we have a cute little graphic novel, which was Heartstopper by Alice Oseman, and I gave this 4 stars. I don't really read much graphic novels, so I don't think it's fair for me to give something 5 stars, but this was just cute. It tells the story of Charlie and Nick. Now, Nick, I believe, is openly gay, and he is one of the only gay people in his school, and then he falls for Charlie. Charlie has never been interested in boys before, and this is just their romance. this was very cute. But I do know that as the series gets on, these two boys deal with an eating disorder. One of the boys deals with an eating disorder. So if that is something that you are sensitive to, just be wary if you are thinking of picking this book up or continuing the series. It doesn't feature in this one, but just be wary that I have been told it does in later books. So I got 4 stars. It was cute. I liked it. I will be continuing, but I didn't love it. Then we have a book with a gift tag in it. Holly Bones Are Real Lemons and Snowflakes. I did give this one 5 stars. It is a contemporary, which is a little bit different for me. But basically, Olive is suffering with her mental health. She has really high highs and really low lows and just doesn't know where to go from that. She thinks she's fine. The book starts with her in a bit of a depressive episode. So this isn't a book for everyone. You do have to be in a somewhat semi-stable mental state, I think, because it does deal with quite heavy topics of mental disorder, mental illness, how people treat you when they realise that you do have a mental condition or a mental illness, and suicide is mentioned a lot. It's not a case of anybody's idealising it or going through with it, but because this is set in a summer camp for children, well, specifically teenagers with mental health conditions, suicide is on the mind of the camp counsellors, and they are trying to be on the lookout for that while also helping the children come to terms with their own conditions and helping them manage it. So this is brilliant. I gave it 5 stars, and there is an incident in here which really annoyed me in the best way, because you know as a reader, from the outside looking in, when the twist is revealed, you realise, yep, okay, something's up. But when you are reading it through Olive's perspective, because it is told in first person, you just follow along with her and you just think this is normal teenage excitement. We do find out her diagnosis, but that's not the point of this book. The point of this book is to say it's okay to be out of balance, it's okay to ask for help. And give it 5 stars. I do want to read more Holly Bone though, but I think I just have to be careful with when I pick her books up, especially since that one would not have been the best book for me a couple of years ago. Then I have Alatsui, I'm not sure of the pronunciation, by Darcy Little Badger, and I give this 5 stars. It doesn't hurt that this is a beautiful edition. But this follows Alatsui, who lives in America. Very similar to ours, but the monsters are real. So these are westernized monsters, like your vampires, your ghosts, your werewolves. But then you also have the Native American monsters, like the Wendigo and other things. Alatsui does have the ability to wake the dead, and she uses that to solve her cousin's murder. But it isn't just a straightforward murder mystery book. There are stories. It is a story about grief and dealing with that. And it's very spiritual, it's very beautifully written, and I thoroughly loved it. The books I can't talk about are the books I enjoyed more than the books that I didn't. I can tell you what I didn't enjoy about books more than I can tell you what I did. But 5 stars, I know, and I do believe this author has another book out, and I am intrigued. So then we have my annual reread at this point. That is Hogfather by Terry Pratchett. This is a very firm favourite. And to no one's surprise, this gets 5 stars. I read it every year at Christmas, and nothing's going to change. But this is the story. This is the Discworld take on the Santa Claus myth belief. Set on Discworld, but basically, in this world, Santa is the Hogfather. Christmas Eve is Hogswatch. Christmas is Hogswatch, and it goes from there. However, the Fat Man, the Hogfather, has gone missing, and it is up to Death to fill his shoes to keep that belief alive. While his adopted granddaughter Susan investigates what has happened and where the Hogfather is, and they are doing this because if there's no Hogfather, there won't be a morning ever again. But it isn't all dark. It's funny. It's a commentary on human nature. But there is a line in here that just sums this book up brilliant, and it says, "Things just happen, what the hell?" And that, I think that sums this book up and the whole Discworld universe up brilliantly. It is illogical and whimsical, but at the same time the logic makes sense on that world. Now then I have Children of Blood and Bone by Tomi Adeyemi. Yes, I finally started this series. No, I don't know why it takes so long, and yes, I did enjoy this. I gave it 4 stars. This basically tells the story of Zelly, who was one of the children of the Magi, and in this world magic was destroyed by the king when he killed over all of the Magi over the age of 13. He did this because he didn't want magic to live anymore, and he only killed those over 13 because they had magic. Those under 13 didn't have magic. So they've lost out on that. When you're 13, you come into your gifts. So, and Zelly saw her mother die, and that has traumatized her and haunted her. Flash forward to a couple of years later, when Zelly is about 16, I would say, and she bumps into the princess. Now, the princess has stolen something that could change the tides of the world, but is being hunted for it by her father and her brother. So Zelly and Zelly's brother go off on an adventure to try and bring magic back. I didn't like how convenient the pairings were in this one. Don't want to tell you too much more, but it is very YA. When did this book come out? Because I know I've had it for a while. So this was published in 2018, so it may just be a product of its time. But the pairings in this were a little bit too convenient for me. I didn't quite like how convenient that part was. And then the last book of the year, technically, which I'll mention in a bit, was Phoenix Flame by Sarah Holland. This has completed 2 squares on my priority list as well. That's getting good. And this is the sequel to Havenfall by the same author. I gave this 4 stars. The only thing wrong with this one, and I think I made the same criticism in the first one, which is over there somewhere, is that these are too short for my liking. These feel more like novellas rather than fully fleshed out novels, which isn't a bad thing when you're looking for something quick and easy, but it's not what I was expecting from it. I wanted something a little bit more padded out, a little bit more fleshed out. It feels, basically, in this book and Havenfall, we follow Maddie, and Havenfall is the inn. It is a crossroads at various different worlds where trade delegations and a peace treaty has been arranged so that all of these worlds, these inhabitants, can travel in peace. And it is the innkeeper's job, which is, I've forgotten Maddie's uncle's name, but it's basically Maddie's uncle, and he is training Maddie to be the next innkeeper. She is the heir, and it is their job to keep the peace. Now in the first book, something goes wrong, and it is Maddie's job to keep the inn running and find out the murderer. So it's Maddie's job to keep everything safe. The plot does move on from this, but I can't tell you what it is for sequel, for spoilers, and I can't really tell you anything off the back. But I do think in this one, Maddie is bisexual. She does have feelings for one of the warriors from another world, and the girl who seemingly is from this world. Did enjoy it. There was one character who I was really confused about, didn't get their motivations, and felt like, because I was confused and there was the big reveal, felt a little bit flat. But that's it. 4 stars, it was good. I will be continuing. I just wish they were bigger. That's all of the 17 books that I read in December, with 2 from November. I'm stacking them up to try and get the thumbnail. But that's it for this video. Give it a like if you like it, and hit that subscribe button if you want to see this, talk about these, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!